Alright, this is a 2022 Yamaha 210 FSH. This is supposed to be a fish and surf combo model. We've got a little wind noise today, so please forgive that. But this boat has, I believe, about 11 hours on it. It has the aluminum tandem axle trailer. This is the more expensive trailer that Yamaha sells. It has the swing away gate. It's aluminum, so you can put it in salt water, not have to worry about it rusting. Hence the plastic fenders, etc. It all keeps it from rusting. And so it's got the really nice trailer on there. You can see right there the Minn Kota Ultera. That is a self-deploying trolling motor with a remote, both a foot remote, and it also has the handheld remote. And it has the autopilot, the GPS, the spot lock, all that good stuff built into that trolling motor. I will say on this boat, there are three scratches on this boat that I know of. You've got this one right here. There is, I guess, both on the other side. There's two more over on this other side. The only thing I know of that could have happened, yep, there's the other one right there. And I believe there's another one right back here. Yep, right there. And those came from one weekend whenever we rented a rental slip, a weekend slip, to keep it in that was narrow and had a bunch of stuff hanging off of it. I thought I had enough bumpers on there to keep that from happening, but apparently I did not. This one's a center console model with the T-top on there. You can see it's also got the T-top storage bag, which we can look at in just a second. You can see it has the telescoping ladder on here. I'll show you a little bit about how that works. Back this up. It simply slides right in, and then you push it up and over, locked in place, and then to get it out, push it in, it comes right out, just like that. Something else that's extra on this boat, this has the thrust vectors from jetboatpilot.com. That's these little fins right here. These do not come standard on a Yamaha jet engine. With a normal Yamaha jet engine, the only thing you have to steer with is this rudder right here. And it does not provide a lot of steering response at low speeds. At high speeds, you can steer fine because you're not steering with the fin, you're steering with the engines. At low speeds, you're not steering as much with the engines, and you're trying to steer with that fin, but it's not enough to really steer very well. However, with these on here, the engines turn right along with the steering wheel at the fin, as you can see. So these rudders fall in the water and they will help you steer at low speeds, and they actually do a great job. You can put this thing exactly where you want it. This also has the side thrusters on it, which is another thing I added to the year, so that you can just activate one engine, because this is a dual jet engine. I believe they're 115 horsepower a piece, but you can just activate one engine in reverse and it shoots water out this side and pushes you the opposite direction. So you can use those side thrusters to put it exactly where you want it. It's great for docking, great for getting in and out of a slip, great for whenever you're trying to tie up to other boats. You can put it right where you want it. You see this has got the patented Yamaha swim deck on it. So your water level whenever you're in the water will be right about here. And so it just sits just barely out of the water. It's easy for somebody to slide up on there and sit right there, sit up here. That's what these back cushions are for. Inside this compartment is actually your clean outs for the jet engines. We'll open that up. So if you were to suck something into one of the jet engines, like a rope or a twig or weed or something like that, you need to get it out of there. It's easy to do. You reach down in here, you can twist these clean out port holders and they come out, and then you can reach right down in there, pull out whatever it is that's in the way, and put those clean out ports back in there. I don't have them locked in right now because I usually just kind of leave that open until we get in the water. That way it doesn't create mold and everything else down in there. You also have kill switches on this so that anytime you have the clean out ports open where you can get to them, it kills the engine. That's what these are, is kill switches right here in this corner. You got the handles here to help you get up. I'm gonna take my shoes off because I don't wear shoes on this boat. We never worn shoes on this boat. We want to protect the marine mat. You can see you've got a tie out here too to be able to pull tubes, gears, surfers, whatever it is you've got. This one also has the pop-out cleats, as you can see right there. All around the gunwale, this thing has tons of cup holders, rod holders. You can see them all the way around. There's cup holders mounted several other places as well. It has the built-in ice chest right there, or built-in space for an ice chest. It comes with that Igloo cooler. You can put whatever cooler you want underneath there and strap it in under that seat so that it's out of the way. We've only got one of the back seats in right now. The other one I've snapped off and put into the console because I don't, normally whenever we're using it, we've only got 6 or 7 people on here. And with that many people, you don't want to put that seat in because it's easier just to walk past here to be able to get to the swim deck. You can see under here, you have rod holders on each side. You've got 2 rod holders that go in there. The end of your rods can go right in there, so it doesn't matter how long they are. This is actually inside of here is where your electric plug-in is going to be for the charger, because this thing has 5 batteries in it. We have got 3 batteries to be able to run your trolling motor off of and other accessories, and you've got 2 batteries to run your engines off of. There's a charger on here that will charge all 5 batteries whenever it's plugged in. Also, it charges all 5 batteries whenever this is running, when the engines are running. So, lots of different ways to make sure and keep those batteries charged up. You can also see this has got the marine mat along the side of the gunwale. Marine mat up here on top where you've got lots of space to be able to set things up here. I like to set my tackle box up here whenever we're fishing. Whenever we're out just hanging out in the cove, you know, we'll put food up there or whatever. A lot of times the kids' phones end up there. But anyway, let's come back here just a little bit. Inside here where we just walked over, that's where you're gonna find a couple of your batteries and as well as your battery connections. So inside here, you can see your 2 batteries that are for running the engine. See if I can get in the shade a little bit, make that visibility better. I also keep a fire extinguisher, first aid kit, and that kind of thing back here, the inflator, that all that good stuff. And then here you can see you've got cutoffs for both the house battery and the starting battery. I'm gonna turn on the house battery right quick just to be able to show you the radio in a minute. You also have an emergency parallel switch so that if you put that in place, it actually connects all 5 batteries. So if you were to run down the batteries for some reason or you had one bad battery, you can connect all 5 of those batteries to be able to start the engines and go wherever you need to go. Put this back down for now. You have a seat here that the back will actually switch to either side. So whenever you're driving, you'll want it like that. You can sit up here on this seat. But whenever you're just hanging out or whenever you're fishing, you flip it this way and you can sit right up here and see right down onto the swim deck or to fish from here, etc. Ignition switches are right here. This is your blower switch to make sure you clean out that engine port, keep all the exhaust out of there if something should happen. Just a fuse reset switch is there. Your kill switch for engines. You've got your navigation anchor lights that can be turned on and off right there. You can see this accessory switch was actually on the left one. It didn't come on until I turned that switch underneath the compartment on, but it left that accessory switch on. So that's what you'd have to turn on to be able to run this Garmin GPS / fish finder, your radio, those kind of things. So you've got a second accessory switch. So if you wanted to mount some other accessories like lights or anything like that onto it, you can run them off that switch. You've got an aerator for your live well that you can turn on and off, or you can turn it to auto so that it just comes on every once in a while to turn on your live well where it pumps water in and out of there. You can turn that on. Here's your bilge pump to be able to go ahead and pump water out of the bilge if you've left it in the water for a long time. And then your horn switch is right there. All these are fuses for those that can be reset by pushing those in on every one of those switches. This screen here is where you would normally see your gauges, hours, whatnot. We'll see if we can kick those on right quick. It's hard to do that looking through the camera. So I'll just turn it to the accessory position. And nope, it's not going to work because I don't have that switch turned on. So let's switch that back on. Turned on. Turn these to the accessory position. You can see there Yamaha Connect, and it brings up the screen to be able to see all your batteries are at almost 12 volts, fuel's at 56%, water says 93 degrees Fahrenheit. That's because that's what the temperature is outside right now. We're not in the water. You can get to your clock settings, different kinds of measurement, all those things through these different buttons. 25 mile an hour, 52.9 mile an hour max, but that's not quite right. This thing really goes about 42 or 43 miles an hour max. 12.1 starboard hours, 11.9 port hours. So that's the two engines. So they've got about 12 hours apiece on them. Averaged about 10.7 miles per hour while out moving around. And again, the water temperature, 93.7 degrees, 0 gallons per hour, because the engines aren't running, has 56.4 gallons of fuel left in it. It's been 132 miles, 2.5 average miles per gallon. That's because we're just usually ticking around and not doing much. So anyway, that's how those work. Your RPM gauges for each of your engines, and they each start separately, as you can see with the two different ignition switches. They're each run separately with the two different throttle handles. And so that's really nice whenever you're trying to get in someplace tight. You want to spin in a circle, just kick that one backwards, this one forwards, and you are going to spin in a circle to your right. You want to spin in a circle to the left, put that one forward, this one in reverse. You'll spin in a circle right in one spot to the left. This thing also has a jet wash on it. The connection for that is right over here in this corner. There is a hose and things in the live well to be able to connect to that with a sprayer so that you can clean this thing out if you get something dirty on the inside. And then you've got the cruise assist and no wake mode. So whenever you're cruising through the no wake zone, you just hit that plus sign and it will take you in half mile an hour increments up to, I believe, 5 miles per hour at no wake. And it's just like a cruise control for no wake. So it will keep it at the right speed, at a consistent speed, without you having to worry about it. All you have to do is drive at that point. Same way with cruise. It doesn't matter how fast you're going, but like if you're surfing and you want to run this thing at 10.5 miles per hour, you just push this forward until you're going 10.5 miles per hour, then hit that plus sign. That puts it into cruise control, and it will lock those engines in at the exact speed they're going so that you continue to go 10.5 miles an hour, and then all you have to do is worry about steering the boat. You don't have to worry about your fuel or anything else anymore. As you probably saw whenever we were looking at the front of the boat, this has a Sirius sound system in it. I spent about $4,000 upgrading the sound system in this boat. It has a wet sound system. So you've got the wet sounds head unit, still has the plastic on it right there. You have a big amplifier in here. I can't remember how big it is. You've got, I believe it's a big 10-inch sub mounted in the front. You've got 2 6.5s that are facing backwards. You also have 2 6.5s, one on each side of the console, that are facing out to the sides. And this thing will rock the cove. It is nuts how loud and good it sounds. It sounds like you're at a concert. It's pretty incredible. I might be able to turn it on for just a second here. I don't want to make all my neighbors mad. We'll go ahead and give it a shot. With me videoing, I don't know that I can actually turn that on, but let me see if I can change the source. Sorry, my video quit whenever the Bluetooth connected to the stereo. I've just got it on FM right now, playing a little bit. I don't know if we can find something that's a little more advantageous to the sound system. Doesn't matter what kind of music you like.
Your wallet?
Imagine.
Who knows? A neat apple.
You're
I said earlier, this thing will absolutely rock the cove. You will control the music in your area whenever you are tied up in a cove somewhere, whenever you've got this thing. Great sound system. Should be able to show you the amp, I think, whenever I open up the center console. So in addition, you've got, you know, a place to set your phone, which is where mine usually goes, is right there. Down here, you've got more chargers. You've got 12 volt, you got a fuse, you've got USBs. You've got another little dish to be able to hold things in. Here you've got another storage that closes. Here is the remote, the hand remote for that Minn Kota Altera. You can see it's got a place for your feet down here whenever you're cruising around and leaning up against the leaning post here. Something else I can show you right quick is if you want to see the engine bay, which I haven't opened this engine bay up in a while. Let's see if we can get it open. Open both at the same time. Yeah, like I said, I haven't opened the engine bay in a while, and they look brand spanking new because they basically are brand spanking new. So you've got the Yamaha TR1s inside there, easy access to your engine and anything that you're going to want to do inside here. Moving forward a little bit, you can see you've got rod holders here on the side of the center console, as well as a place for pliers, knives, all those kind of things that you would use when you're fishing. You've got holes up here in the top of the T-top so that those rods can go through that. Right now, I have the surfboard carrier mounted on top of this, so it covers those up, but if you take that surfboard carrier off, it's just a few snaps, then you'll be able to put those rods on the side, no problem. Also up here on the T-top carrier, I've got this storage case that I mounted up here. It's made for it by Yamaha. You've got lots of storage. You've got this zipper pouch here, or sometimes I'll put phones and things up there. Right now, I think I've got five water or life vests, you know, up inside that storage. So it's just a convenient place to keep them so that they're up there and out of the way, and we know we've always gotten enough in the boat. It's no problem. This little mirror I mounted up here does have a crack on it. Happened the first day that we actually towed it down the road before we even got to the water. So not sure what happened, but those are replaceable. I think I bought that for like 25 bucks on Amazon. It's not one of the expensive mirrors. You've got the Garmin 126 SV, I believe is the model number on this Garmin fish finder. It is touchscreen. It also has the controls on the side, power button. We should have power to that, so we can go ahead and fire that up right quick. You can see what it looks like. I don't know what it'll show out here in the middle of dry land, but we shall see. Yeah, it's a 126 SV Ultra. This thing will show the map of the lake. It's got all the preloaded maps in there, as well as your two different kinds of depth finder. You've got to agree to that. And so, yep, that's where it was last. And then now you can see where it is now. You've got this depth finder that gives you a lot of clarity around structure on the bottom. You've got the depth finder that gives you a lot more clarity, in my opinion, on the fish that are in between the bottom and the top. And then this is your GPS map. So that's one of the views you can have. You can set it up with any kind of view that you want. Here is just the map. Here's where we're at. Here is a split between the high contrast below you as well as the side views. So it will scan to either side too, so you can see structure that's on the sides. Oh, I'd have them set up shortcut four. So I'm just set up three of them. Okay. But it's got a ton of different capabilities. You can add even more to it if you wanted to. Go ahead and turn that off. Just hold down on that power button. It turns it off. Okay, we're back on there. You see, you've got a cup holder up here. There's another one back behind this GPS. What else am I leaving out here? I think that's about it on the front. Storage underneath these is really handy. So you can open this up. You got two storage trays in this door that really nice to have. We keep our dock lines and stuff up here. I've got some fishing markers down there. There's your charging unit. It charges all those batteries like we talked about earlier. There's one of the batteries mounted there. I can't remember what I've got in that dry case now. You can see you've got a lot of cord here actually to be able to this one's just the extra cord that I bought to hook up when it's in the slip, but a lot of cord to be able to pull out and be able to get to a plug in whenever you are parked in a slip. And I've got the bumpers up there that access through here. Some more storage there. Inside of this compartment, you've actually got it lined. You can use it for an ice chest. That's what it's designed for, is to be able to use as an ice chest to keep fish in if you want to keep your fish cold. Or you can just store things in there. This one is set up with a trash can. So you've got a trash can right here built into the door. We've got the other two other batteries mounted over here, as well as more storage space back behind there to be able to store whatever you need to. You can see there's two more rod holders below the gunwale there on this side. You know, the same cup holders and setup that you have on the other side. While we're up here, your anchor storage is also your sub box. So the sub is mounted down in there. And then we've got anchor and rope all mounted in here. It's set up ideally for a naval style anchor that will mount where it just sits in here, and then you can lock it in place. We are on a rock lake where we have all rock bottoms. Navy anchor won't really hold you. You pretty much have to have a box anchor if you want to stay in place. Set that anchor storage. This is the GPS for this Minn Kota, so it knows where it's at. And that's what the spot lock works off of. It's what the autopilot works off of, is that little GPS puck right there. You can see pop out cleat here to be able to tie your anchor up to. Those wet sound speakers. We've also got more storage underneath here. So this is where we've got all our surf stuff. We've got the surf ballast kit, the hose and the water pump, which is the high speed water pump to be able to pump water into that ballast. I've got the surf kit there. Inside of this, which is the one that mounts underneath the swim platform. It's made by Yamaha for this boat to be able to create a surf wake. Got my bucket in there, which normally would be holding chum and things like that whenever you're fishing, but I've just got our surf rope and some straps and things inside the bucket. But you've got a lot of storage down under there. And then the really big storage is actually underneath this seat right here, which normally two people can sit on that seat. Whenever you pull right here, this opens up and you've got a ton of storage in here. It actually came, I'm trying to remember where, it's added somewhere in here, I think with, this is made to be able to use as a changing room. So there's some stuff that will mount to these up here and comes out, and you've got basically a curtain that will hang down here so that you can get in here and change if you want to. We don't use it that way. We use it for storage primarily. And so you can see we've got a lot of things stored, like the seat and the seat back that would normally be on that other side. I always keep some waters down here. The foot control is underneath there for the Minn Kota. And then you've just got a curtain up there. You can see one of the amps mounted right there for the stereo. But the great thing about this is if you unhook those down there, you can get to all of your wiring for this entire boat is all right behind that curtain. And you've got plenty of access to just step down in here and get to it. You even got a step to help you step down in, so it's not quite so far. And so, really like that setup. You've also got a light in here that whenever you turn on your lights to the outside, it turns on this light. And, oh wait, no, actually, you just push that, it turns that light on, so that you'll have a light inside of here. And there's your horn. It's just a really nice setup with the center console. So working our way on around, you've got more storage underneath here. These seat backs just slide out just like that. And then you can move them, I'll just set it up here. You can open up this storage here. So There's another storage bay. We didn't even have anything in there. There's so much storage, we don't use it all. And then behind that is your live well. And inside the live well, you can see the hose and the sprayer for the jet wash. This back. All of this marine mat that's in the floor will snap out. I've had it snapped out to clean it up. So it's easy to take in and out. If you're doing a lot of fishing, you may want to take that marine mat out because it can sometimes be hard to clean. That's why we don't wear shoes in here. But when you are out in the boat and on the water, this marine mat is fantastic on your feet. And so if you're just out swimming, tubing, skiing, surfing, you know, there's nothing better than this marine mat to be able to walk around on. So that's why we have it in here most of the time. All these seats will snap out up in the front as well. They also make a mount. There's a table mount underneath here, but they make a mount that you can put up in the front to fill that in, make that a platform that you can fish off of. I usually do fine just fishing up here, and I'll just step up here and then onto that bow and stand there whenever I'm fishing. One thing we didn't show, just a little thing, we do have the surfboard storage up here, so you can store two surfboards up on top of the T-top. And this T-top will come off if you want it to. It's just a matter of loosening those off and taking all that down, but it drives down the road just fine with the T-top on there, and even with the surf bag on there, or surfboard storage on there, it's no problem. So this is the Yamaha 210 FSH. I believe we've covered just about everything on the boat. So hope you like it.